I wasn't prepared to say anything, none of this kind of shit, man, but it's like, outcast would not be outcast. Our label tried so hard to make us try. Like, I mean, like, I think in our bio, we didn't write this shit. They called me the poet and Big Boy the player or some shit. Like, it was like some Southern tribe shit. But we didn't even like it. We just want to rap, but they wanted us to be tribe so bad. And we loved them niggas so bad. We was like, okay, we'll be a street tribe. We was robbing niggas and stealing cars and shit. So we, yeah, imagine me trying to rob niggas.
He was truly the leader of the organization.
He was truly the leader of the
organization. Sad, just people just sad.
All the players, all the hustlers. I'm talking about a black man in heaven here. You know what I'm saying?
To get shit off my sternum, chest. I never played but made many of moves. I still blame it on the session cause I can't remember the dude. I guess I feel that getting a Benz is out of the question. The world is yelling hootie hoo, but in my pocket's nothing but gum and lint. To sum the shit up, I'm broke, nothing but hope. So Big Boy, tell them what you told.
I'm traveling up to Jersey with four keys off in my trunk and thinking of starting the ways to get that motherfucker clump. See, yes, I be that nigga that with that sense off in my chest. Smoking and choking even them token blacks. The world is a trick. She strong niggas surviving, the weak niggas they die. I never fuck no white bitch. I stop eating a pigsty. Be activating that low jack if the fleet would have been stolen. Hamilton wrote this over. The B.I.G. has spoken. Cause it's like this.
I either wanna
bend
or
stops. Similar to the ones that call in the wild. I'm in the Benz is where I be, doing about 100 miles. The world is fucked up, how these niggas be driving strong. You take a homicide with their bodies off in your trunk. To me, the car does not belong, I use that strong arm. Robbery, robbing spree, look at me, WMB, backwards. Taking you to the chop shop with these verses. Coming around the projects, make you sleep off in the purses. I got a word of wisdom, for those who must be cis. You'll be needing a physical therapist, cause you can't fuck with this.
While you sat down by the seashore, thinking about some seashells. I was around the corner from Pleasant Hill, thinking about the B12. Well, maybe not for long, because I just done seen the light. I'm packing my screwdriver, so see, I'm gonna be alright. Just moving the steering wheel side to side like a slalom. Now I ain't got no problem, I'm just breaking the steering column. I spot him in the middle of the martyr parking lot. I'm hearing a voice in the back of my head yelling, Andre, stop. But do I stop now? I figure it's a combo. But now I'm going down, cause the folks wanna run up. Dang.
While my nigga be in school, thinking about the second album at the dungeon, shooting pool like ES to the PN, cause we just to the B in the zone. Honey, I'm home, but I'm not married, carried a lot of problems around, being frustrated. And now I'm sitting at the end of the month, I just made it like you made the B team. And like your daddy's wife, you're making a call. You heard the ATL, and so back the hell up off.
Softly, as if I play piano in the dark. Found a way to channel my anger, not to involve. The world's a stage and everybody got to play their part. God works in mysterious ways, so when he starts the job of speaking through us, we be so sincere with this here. No drugs or alcohol, so I can get the signal clear as day. Put my Glock away, I got a stronger weapon that never runs out of ammunition, so I'm ready for war, okay?
Throw your hands in the air and wave them like you just don't care. And if you like fishing grits and all the pimps, everybody let me hear you say, oh yeah, girl.
Linden Boulevard, represent, Zen Tribe Called Quest, represent, Zen. The mic is in my hand, I'm never hesitant. My favorite jam back in the day was Eric B for president. Rude boy composer, step to me, you're over. Brothers wanna flex, you're not Mad Cobra. MC short and black, there ain't no other. Trini born black like Nia Long's grandmother. Dippin' shot they all that, pipe dog ditto. Honey, tell your man to chill, or else you'll be a widow. Did not you know that my style's a top dollar? The 5 foot assassin, I can fleas off his collar. Hip hop scholar, since B&D had to adopt. The hide of Muggsy Bogues, complexion of a hockey puck. You better ask somebody on how we flip the script. Come to a tribe show and watch the three kids rip.
Queens is in the house, represent, Zen. A Tribe Called Quest, represent, Zen. No teaming up the style, cause it gets irreverent. A Tribe Called Quest, represent, Zen. Here we go. You know that I'm the rebel, throwing out the wicked like God did the devil. Funky like your grandpa's drawers. Don't test me, we end like that. You're dead like Presley. When we coming through, get tickets to see me. We work for the paper, so there'll never be a preemie. Lyrics are abundant, cause we got it by the mass. Egos are our idol, cause the music is the jazz. Venezuela on the pitch, curveball, catch it. I think I got it locked, just move while I latch it. Right, now I must move with the quickness. In comes Shahid, so we must bear the witness.
Longer than I had one by Dr. Seuss. Love a girl in Daisy Duke.
the rhymes and more rhymes, kick the beats and more beats. We'll have you scratching in your head like Shaheen on techniques. For those who wanna oppose, then take a stand. But for now, just shut your shit and clap your hands. Steven at the Home Depot. Gloratin is in the house, I can't forget Southside. Walk past some seas like that girl did the far side. I'm labeled as the cat's meow, the MC with the know-how. Act like you know, not now, but right now. Beast of the East on MCs, I have a feast. I'd eat that ass like quiche, crack a smile like Shanice. Shit out Jamaica scene, Jamaica Queens, but you can find me out in Georgia or anywhere in between. Now if my partners don't look good, Malik won't look good. If Malik don't look good, the quest won't look good. If the quest don't look good, Queens won't look good, but since the sounds are universal, New York won't look good. Pitch a fight, losing a battle, come on, get off it. Put down the microphone, son, surrender, forfeit. Did I hear something about a crew? What they wanna do, you better call Mr. Babyface so he can bring out the cool in you. Or it'll be a sad love song being sung by Tony Braxton. And I'll dissect you like a fraction. Or you wanna be tough at MCs, I'll pop you like a zit. You wanna be the champion, more like Chief some shit. Big up myself every time when it comes to this. MCs be running scared as if they watching The Exorcist. I kick more game than a crackhead from Hempstead. My style's a milk, man, you think that I was breastfed. You know the steeler when the dicky dog is on the scene. I dedicate this to all the MCs out of Queens. That goes for Onyx, LL, Run DMC, Akinelli, Nasty Nas, and the Extra P. You be the trotter up and down, man, there ain't no other. Enough respect to all my peeps that made the album cover. Yo, Tip, don't worry none, you know I get the party jumping. Get on the mic and break them off a little something. Yo, Tip, don't worry none, you know I get the party jumping. Get on the mic, my man, and break them off a little something.
La, la. The bomb shit, so recognize me. Kids memorize me. Every day I be scrounging. Really, I be lounging. I play the down low. Very, very incognito. Aries is my sign. I know that I can rhyme. Sometimes I rhyme in riddles, plus I make the honeys wiggle. Intellect is the major. Some heads like to wager. The skills on the hill, overlooking dollar bills. Man, you're crazy, thinking you can phase me. The app doesn't study me and nonsense money. Life seems to need me. MCs seem too cheesy with their duty ass renditions of defeating competition. I rock to the road, man. Yes, I'm a soul man. Bet your bottom dollar video will make you holler as you stand at attention. Did I forget to mention? MCs will give me 20 if I sense that they act funny. Lyrics are abundant, right there I sound redundant. Just mentioning the fact that the area is fat. I dwell in the under, so honey, it's no wonder that I keep plenty of tail. While I even get white, I'm a bank hitting head crack. There, money, take that. Breaking niggas off, cut the bank, then I'm off. All my Nikes match my little hat. Beat joint is mad fact. Got the cutter of the box if a kid think he's ox. For TME's creator, the poetry relator is him like Betsy Ross. Let me tell you who's the boss.
Sentimentalist lay all grand dragons. Rap sharpest number two, then I'm stabbing. Somebody let me hold a number two pencil, cause they test. Somebody let me hold a number two pencil, cause they test.
I fly through the night, yeah. Busy and raw with some Sprite. Lyrics we put inside ya. Listen to these ATL riders. Keep your head straight. The streets full of snakes. Slithering, making deals, delivering. That we got you shivering. Paranoia. 1500, go to the lawyer. After paying his rent, dollars and cents. Still
in
big bulls, put up a fence. We moving on till the crew is on. Okay,
here you go. This song is Sugar Baby
Shadow.
I'm one
four,
the
my
pants,
G
double O, D
and
I.
Yeah.
Need an M and a O.
Don't try and take your brain,
pistol
and they gon' bang. Plus,
drain
your lights and
bowls,
then I'm rolling.
Now,
get it
tucked to cold. Tell me, homie, anybody disrespect my zone, we gon' get it on till we get it gone. Or you might get it right if you get it wrong, or you gon' get
some. I didn't find you with the fire, spanking cop, pickers, girls, spitting, get rid of figure, getting your cheese out of shoulder. I'm out that type of roll, all over your finger. Back in the way, we'll start. Think of a spot, we keep it all day. Top for the line, five star. I think they'll get out of your like a true delete. I want to
get it. Been here, this is, get one of the five to lay it down around here. Gold at the platinum all over the wall. If you ever take the book, yo, it had big balls. Lay it down.
time. Yo, I hit it, get it gone, now I'm out of mind. Went from World Capital Studies to the Hunter Spokes. People still talking about the last rhyme I broke. 87 was the year that I first stepped in. I'm hollering at B.E. doing time in the pen. I say,
what is up, boy? I crept in, stepping all over your best friend. Your wet bin, the lyrical last dance, the smoke that sets in. The young and the rest in, some of the best in the dirty south and Midwest in. Hemisphere, they wanna be this here. The fan of me, oh, I'm gonna run these verses to make you see this here. Tried to dock and I put my plug off in they good socket. No, the D to the F is gone forever. Rock it, knock it down.
The cheese that's the chemo who's known as a teacher. Southwest young brother bringing a pain through your speaker. It's like a disease to fiend for the cheese you need. I'm up in ease and feeling exhibited chilling while dealing with the devil himself. Increase my wealthy more than 10 times the average minimum wage. How to track with these days are changing rapidly. Steady tactics creatively maximized with proper investment. Can't be hesitant with them dead president. Or you lose, or you can lose your cash. What? No, two.
With
our
pound, I'm behind the screen. Yeah.
I know a whole lot of brothers in the rap game, but most of them are in it for the shiny things. They want to snatch all 10, maybe stack about 4. They want to live in the house, but don't want no grassy growth. See, what you need to do is learn the tricks of the trade. Go to work, put it down, and then get paid. If only two of us don't get caught for making a sale. I'm one, and if you the other, bro, I can't tell. Ain't nobody that can come in and get in the zone. Trying to kill 4 birds with about 15 stones.
The C stands for Cool Breeze, who's known as the champ. Freddie Calhoun, the coolest cutter at camp.
Hey, my ones and my twos got your whole town shook. You better listen to your corner and watch for the hook.
The C stands for Cool Breeze, who's known as the champ. Freddie Calhoun, the coolest cutter at camp.
Hey, my ones and my twos got your whole town shook. You better listen to your corner and watch for the hook. You better listen to your corner and watch for the hook.
Here in 1992, we present the fabulous What's the Scenario remix. Whereas there are 7 MCs,
boy,
6 which are in physical form, and 1 which is in spiritual essence. And he goes by the name of the...
Check the rock, hope that answer get God effing.
Shit.
I lick buckshots, put madman, I rip up stages, lay down your wages, I'm wild like Larry Davis. Extra, extra, pick up a clip, I tear ass out the frame,
huh?
And grab my dick. While I rock, I'm like a robot kid, I drop bombs, I'm rugged and deadly, so I shit on a penny. A baseball bat, a bastard, I'm bad news, I'm raging clever, cut those approves. I'm deaf on a phone, no, my skills are pono. You say, oh no, you bitch ass homo. I bag up weight, electrifying, I'm prime time, I slaughter slime, I'm the greatest of all times. Sick ass brother, nasty ass nigga, pump slugs in your face and jump that ass in the river. 2 tears in a bucket, fucking kick the can. Say what, I'm a bad, bad man.
Quick is how I flip from the tip of the lip, punching out hits like Gladys Knight and the Pips. The 5-foot assassin has just raided your area. Your booty rounds are whacking, that's the reason I ain't hearing you. So, roll up the red carpet, cause I'm getting this. Vanilla Ice Platinum? That shit's ridiculous. Excuse my French, but profanity is all I knew. And do you ever sell out? Oh, yeah, FQ2, and let it be known. I'm not the one to step to. You better off calling D-Nice to your rescue. Freestyle fanatic, probably the best around. As for corny MC, like Chuck D, I shut him down. The article done of hip-hop, and I won't stop. The 5-foot assassin has come to wreck nut shop. So do like Michael Jackson and remember the time. Put on your dancing shoes, put on your dancing shoes.
Here we
go,
yo.
To back, no batteries included and no strings attached, no holds barred, no time for move faking, got to get to loot so I can bring home the bacon. Brothers front, they say the drop can't flow, but we've been known to do the impossible like Broadway Joe. So sleep if you want, like who will help you get your Z's, true, but here's the real scoop. I'm all that and then some, short, dark and handsome, bust a nut inside your eye to show you where I come from. I'm vexed, fuming, I've had it up to here, my days of pain, dues are over, acknowledge me is in there, yeah. Head for the border, go get a taco, I see record from the jump street, meaning from the get-go, sit back, relax, and let yourself go. Don't sweat what you heard, but act like you know.
You are now listening to For All Nerds Show, a podcast about geek and pop culture from the perspective of people of color. For All Nerds is hosted by DJ Ben Amin and Tatiana Keen Jones. For All Nerds Show is a member of the Loudspeakers Network, where we always say rest in peace to our founder, Combat Jack.
For All Nerds Show is powered by our listeners. Everything we do from our podcasts, live events, our website are all independently funded. Please continue to support us through our Patreon page at patreon.com/forallnerds.
Welcome to the Fan Bros, the show where the bros are fans. Doodle.
And what's up, y'all, and welcome to another episode of the For All Nerds Show. The voice of the Urban Geek, the podcast where we discuss geek culture according to people of color. You see the color shining today. And as always, it's your boy, DJ Ben Amin, a.k.a. Halal Jordan, Charlie Brownish, Lightwork Igami, Ben Grin, Toss a Coin to your Ninja, Doctor Who's Man is this, here in the spaceship tonight. And as always, I'm joined by
Tatiana King, the Grand Duchess of Tech, also known as Gucci Mane DeLorean, Lambo Calrissian, Beretta Scott King, Sean Jean-Luc Picard, and the Ting of the North.
And we are back. Thank you for joining us. Thank you once again to everybody, all of our new listeners. You know, the growth of the For All Nerds Show has been tremendous over the last few weeks, months, years, whatever you want to call it, and it's been beautiful to see. So thank you to everybody. Once again, this is For All Nerds Show. I know a lot of people are here from our views from the 616 show, where it's coming down to the end, folks. We are just over on views from the 616. We are discussing WandaVision right now, and this Friday is the finale.
Big finale. It's been a wild journey, and one with unexpected happiness. Like, we knew it was going to be a good time, but we didn't realize how good of a time and how well the show is going to be, you know, written and acted and all that stuff. Like, we at least me, I trust Marvel, but you never really know what you're going to get, especially with something. This is a new approach for them when it comes to the TV show. So I've had a blast thus far. I know we're going to continue to have a blast because we get a little bit of a break and then we go right into The Falcon and Winter Soldier. So, but it's, as far as WandaVision is concerned, I want to just thank everybody who's been riding with us, everyone who's discovered us. Even if you're late, that's all right. Just go back and listen to the previous episodes. You can do that. Or you can go to our YouTube channel, youtube.com/forallnerdstv, because all of our review episodes are there as well. Every episode from episode 1 through 7 and soon 1 through 8 now, and soon episode 9, which is the finale episode. Damn.
Yeah.
We've done a lot in a short period of time.
In a short period of time. Yeah, it's been, we did basically, we did the first two episodes on one episode, then we did one episode per episode of Views from the 616. You can also follow us on Twitter, on Instagram, Views from 616, the number 616.
Yes.
And you should already be following us at For All Nerds on all social medias and all that. Make sure you're subscribed on all the various platforms out there, SoundCloud, iTunes, Spotify. It don't matter. Wherever you listen to podcasts, just find For All Nerds, hit that follow button. And thank you so much, because yeah, it has been a wild ride. Like, just one, it's just like when we did Safe Negro Pod, when we did Castle Black, like the reaction from the listeners, from everyone who's been discovering us, who's been like, yo, y'all are thorough as hell. And then just everyone coming at us with all their theories, all their ideas. That's everyone fun. Mad at me right now because I'm rolling Team Hayward right now.
Because you, okay, where's my koofy? Maybe Luna could put the koofy on me. I don't know. But you are allowing yourself, are you allowing the coon chip to activate?
Wow. Wow.
Listen, no, but no. Ben Amin is defending Hayward, Wayward Hayward, but he has some actually really good points.
Yes.
So you gotta listen to Views from the 616 to understand.
Wanda Maximoff is a terrorist. You know,
it's activating, but I mean, I'm just playing. But Ben Ami has some questionable views when it comes to this. But I also agree with him in some ways too. So again, make sure you are following us and subscribe to us on your favorite podcast platform. So you have to subscribe or follow, whatever it's called, depending on what you're on, to For All Nerds. That's how you get access to Views from 616 podcast. And as we said, all of our recaps and discussions and Easter egg hunts and all that regarding WandaVision and also all the future MCU projects.
Because Winter Soldier, Black Widow coming up, Loki, What If, Miss Marvel,
Eternals and Spider-Man are all this year.
Yo, silly.
I think Hawkeye too. Wow, yeah, Hawkeye too, I think. Jeez, for real?
Well, I don't like him, so whatever. Oof, but
oof. Yeah, but I see, you ain't like Vision and Wanda, and then, you know.
No, that's different.
Yeah.
That's different. I said I didn't like them. I liked them individually. I didn't agree with the, at first, and this is years ago, I didn't agree with their relationship. But now I'm all in. That's cool.
Yep.
Hawkeye, I don't like that nigga.
But now we got Kate Bishop.
I do like Kate Bishop.
I love me some Kate Bishop.
I fucks with Kate Bishop.
Kate Bishop is a dope ass character.
I don't fucks with Black Widow. Don't talk to me about that. Don't at me. If you at me, I'm going to ignore you.
Yeah, but they got the new Black Widow now. Okay. Replacement Black Widow.
Okay. if you notice, if you are watching us on Twitch, as you absolutely should be, or at least on a YouTube, if you're not watching live, but twitch.tv/4allnerds, you would notice Ben, I mean, I look like Tia and Tamara because we're wearing our fire new merch. Thank you, Sketch Sawyer, for this exclusive, and this is not hyperbole, this is literally exclusive design that you can only get on the 4allnerds TeePublic page, teepublic.com/stores/4allnerds. Look at this beautiful. This is Storm with the Mohawk on a motorbike. I don't know what kind of motorcycle this is, but Sketch Sawyer actually he has a lot of amazing designs. He's placed Miss Marvel, Captain Marvel, and a couple other people. He has just beautiful versions or depictions of them, along with like a unique motorcycle. So as I said, make sure if you want your own, as Benami has it on his beautiful pink t-shirt, I have it on a black crew neck. You can get it pretty much on any, almost every color, on any type of shirt, t-shirt, regular t-shirt, heavy t-shirt, crew neck, hoodie. You can also get it on items. You can get all of our designs on actual like things like phone cases, books, notebooks. Benami has the Nawi notebook, which is super special edition limited because you can't even get that shit no more.
But you can get a Storm notebook, though. You can get definitely a Storm notebook fire now. Storm
it
notebook.
It looks good. You can get it on a pillow, and you can actually see exactly what the design is going to look like on these products. You get it on a tote bag. You get mad stickers. Everything you want is there. Also, important note, if you are part of our Patreon, patreon.com/4allnerds, you get a special discount code that works on everything that's full price. Can't say it here because it's only for the Patreon fam. So make sure that if you haven't seen that discount code, you log in, go get your discount code. You can get whatever merch you like. And of course, we're still going to be coming out with new designs as we go along. Hey, if you want to even design something for us, holla at us. We'll talk to you.
We actually might have a little contest or something, you know.
You saw that, Ben. Yeah, we might got a contest or something on the way. So
yeah,
you know.
Real quick, real big shout out to the homie Stretch Sawyer for designing this shirt. I just got mine in the mail today from TeePublic, and it's so beautiful. The bike is purple. That purple.
Hey.
Storm with the Mohawk looking dope. So make sure you go to our store, teepublic.com/store/4allnerds. And then also head over to Sketch Sawyer. That's Sketch Sawyer, SawyerSawyer.com. And check out all the rest of my man's work. He has a comic book called Butcher Queen, which is fire. He's got his other women with motorcycle art. He's got a book of that where you can cop. So enough stuff. Make sure you go check out his whole line over at StretchSawyer.com, and thank you once again to this shirt. I'm about to order a notebook. I'm gonna get some stickers, you know.
He's gonna do down. the whole product run.
Yeah, you know how I do.
Right, and as usual, well now usual, we telling you if you see some fire merch, especially like the little, as I call him, little Vision Vert. If you see some fire merch on our store, buy it. We're telling you now to get it while you can, because we never know when or if TeePublic might pull one of our designs because somebody's
T-Public.
Hating.
Somebody else will pull.
Okay, well, somebody else. The DMCA is hating. Yes. So just again, if you see it and you're kind of thinking about it, you're like, oh, I'm not sure. You might just want to get it right away.
Mm-hmm.
We don't know. Anything else, Ben, before we go into, I just want to get everyone prepared for what we're about to talk to or who we're about to talk to.
Yeah, because that's also, you know, some hot heat. But like you said, make sure you are watching us twitch.tv/4allnerds every Monday and Thursday at 1 p.m. We broadcast live. Monday is our MCU wrap up and whatever else that turns into. And Thursday is our, you know, the regular live show that you're listening to and watching probably right now. You know, right. Say what up. Make sure you hit follow. Hit subscribe if you're feeling, you know, froggy like that. Jump. And, you know, about time for this interview, though, because people are feeling real froggy out here on these internets, boy. Woo. People jumping into these streets want to get smacked by a car.
Hi, I'm Professor Brandon Obunu, a scientist who studies genetics and epidemics. And when I'm not doing long division, I'm listening to For All Nerds.
Hey, yo, this is Danny Lore.
And this is Vida Ayala, and we are
Twin Speaks.
And when we are not writing Ironheart or
James Bond,
we are listening to
For All Nerds.
Hi, my name's Genevieve King, and I play Jackie Veda on Netflix's Lock and Key. When I'm not cooking up new recipes in my kitchen, then I'm listening to For All Nerds.
Hey, everybody. This is Peter Ramsey. I am the director of Rise of the Guardians and one of the directors of Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. And I like to listen to For All Nerds with Tatiana and the great Benjamin.
Hey, this is Hiro Kanagawa, actor and playwright. And you are listening to For All Nerds all the way.
Hi, this is Lexi Alexander. And I'm a filmmaker and a writer. And when I'm not playing with my vintage toys and feeding myself and my dog, then I'm listening to For All Nerds.
Hey, what's up? This is Otto Asado, and when I'm not on television and movie sets, I am listening to For All Nerds.
We always have our ears to the street for any news and controversy that affects the world of fandom. And today we have a couple of special guests because there is some important matters happening. And you know we always want to keep you informed, especially when it affects people of color. And especially considering it's International Women's Month, this really, really affects women and women in comics. And we're actually talking to a couple of folks from Women in Comics Collective. And these folks actually include a very good friend of the show. Her name is Regine Sawyer, who is the founder of the Women in Comics. And we're also joined by Alice Machi Lee, who is on the WinSee Advisory Board. So thank you both for coming. Really appreciate your time. I know there's a lot going on. Could be very stressful. So we're not here to cause more stress. We're just here to get to the bottom of exactly is what is going on, because there's a lot of word. There's a lot of word on social media about, and maybe even a lot of confusion. So before we get into the nitty-gritty of that, just for our listeners, can you just please introduce yourselves and explain to us, what is Women in Comics? What is WinSee?
Okay, so I'm Regine. I am the coordinator and founder of Women in Comics Collective International, WINC for short. I know when you see the WIN and you see the C, you're like, wait, what is it? WINC? Yeah. Is it WinSee? It's WINC. One of our founding members, Jody Tong, coined it, and we've been around for about 9 years. We host events around the country. They're professional and educational events. We're about uplifting the community as a whole, but especially the community for women and marginalized gendered people. Mm. And that's what we do. Excellent. I'm also a writer and publisher at Lock It Down Productions.
Excellent. And we've mentioned that you actually have a few stuff out in the world now for DC. I mean, you've been doing this for years and years, but most recently you have a couple of things out, some projects out with DC Comics.
Yes, we did.
And they were sold out too. I went by Anyone Comics and I could not find it.
Hey. Well, we're definitely going to talk more about your work. Also, Alice, can you just please share your involvement on the advisory board and how you factor into this?
Yeah, I've been a member of WINC for many years now. I kind of lost count as to how long I've been a part of it. But, you know, I've been a part of a lot of panels, a lot of the conventions. And I am very excited to be a member of the advisory board now that we finally have one. And I am here to do what it takes to support women in comics.
Absolutely. And Regine, can you just give us a brief overview of how Wink came about? Like, you just one day woke up and said, let's make a collective. Like, where did this come from?
Well, it actually started, and this leads us into the larger story. So this is great. It started when I was asked to do a Women in Comics panel. I was asked to moderate Ray Felix, who is the founder and organizer of Bronx Heroes Comic Con, asked me to have this Women in Comics panel at his show. Mm-hmm. So that's what we did. We gathered several women, more than several. We had 8 women on the panel. This is back in 2012. And people really loved the panel. So did the panelists. And the reason why is because a lot of times during that time, you didn't see a lot of women in comics panels, especially with, specifically with women of color on panel. Mm-hmm. So I want to preface that. So you would see them around the country, but you didn't see a whole panel of women of color. And that's what we had. And that's what we had. So afterwards, some of the panelists and I were talking about possibly doing more things. And one panelist in particular, Aletha E. Martinez, she had been in the industry at the time, mm-hmm. 13 years. She had a wealth of work and is, I mean, her career is incredible. She's in the industry 20 years at this point.
Yeah, she's a legend.
And she had mentioned that, you know, I never get invited to these things. I never get invited to panels and events and such. And that really like hurt my heart when she said that. And I just said to her, I was like, well, we definitely need to do more things. So from there, Ray had like a lot of art events in the Bronx at that time. And he invited us several times to come and do art shows. And so we did them. I co-curated them. And it was wonderful because the members, they participated wholeheartedly. You know, I ran around and picked up art. Other members dropped up art. We would have we'd have like little panel discussion socials. We'd all bring liquor. We'd all bring food. Like, it was just, I mean, there was one time, I don't know how anybody just did not walk out of there stumbling. We probably did have a few because there was open bar. Everybody brought liquor, but only maybe like 2 people bought food. So
this group, well, this is not a stuffy group. This is a group that's of like-minded people who want to build a family.
Exactly. And that's what we had. So as we went along, more people became aware of us. And we started doing panels at other shows. We were asked to do workshops at one point. I had never done a workshop before, just like I'd never done an art show. And, you know, I figured it out and we did that. And around 2015, Ray had mentioned that, you know, he didn't want to do Bronx Heroes Con at the time. At least for 2015, he kind of wanted to put it on hiatus. He wanted to concentrate on other things. He kind of felt like some of the folks that usually come to his shows really, you know, he wasn't really feeling them. And he kind of wanted to partner with a group of women because we kind of like, we make people feel safe. Mm-hmm. You know, we feel safe and others feel safe. So whether you're a man, you're a woman, you're non-binary, you know, whatever your gender, folks always feel welcome with us. So we said, you know, why don't you do a Women in Comics Con? You know, I can help you. And I said, I don't know about that. That's a lot of work. And he said, no, I can help you. And I said, I don't know. So he asked me a couple of times before I finally said, okay, you know, let's do it. So at the time he had already had the funding because he usually got funding for the events that he did during the year. And he had a space already set up. He had the Bronx Library. And so we had the show. We got it together in a month. Mm. We got the show together in a month. He led point on that. And I did like some of the scheduling, and I hosted, I think, 2 panels, 2 workshops. Like, it was arduous, but it was a great show. And then from there, in 2016, I took lead management on that from 2016 to 2019. And we had a really, really, really good run. It was a wonderful convention, but outside of that, we started doing so much more. Like by 2015, we had already done a New York Comic Con panel. We had already done events across the country. We had like library events at San Diego Comic Con.
Yeah.
So we were just this budgeting group. And so there was just much happening going on.
So Regine, can we rewind a little bit? Because the con is only a small part of what Wink does. Can we talk a little bit more about the origin story of Wink International period and how you formed it to deal with, you know, making a space for women in the industry and what motivated you to do that?
Yeah, it's very good. It's actually my next question because I'm curious to know, you know, besides that what does, you know, in terms of being supportive to other women creators and creators of color, what is Wincy doing or Wink doing?
Well, what we've always done was put folks on panels. That was a big thing. It was getting folks exposed so that people could see that women of color specifically are in this industry and do phenomenal work and should be hired. So we started with the panels at first. And again, the purpose was to get exposure. Okay. So as we did more and more panels, not only were people exposed, but they also got work. They got work from companies who would ordinarily not see them. Because also in the beginning, for women in general, especially for women of color, we often don't feel comfortable going out in public spaces, especially in the art space. And that was one of the things that a lot of the members said initially, like, I don't like going to cons. Like, people are not used to seeing women on the floor. Like, it can be very abusive. It can be very scary. Like, some folks didn't even want to go to do book signings because someone would come up and be like, you're a woman? Like, we didn't realize, like, well, my name is on the cover. Mm-hmm. And you didn't realize, you know, you didn't possibly presume. So the whole thing was to make sure that folks knew that we weren't an anomaly within the comic book industry, and also to make us feel safe. So we sort of brought our safety with us as we created these panels at these various shows, in the sense that as people saw us, got used to us, not only would we have a panel, we would usually have some type of party. So people could come to the party and meet us and chill with us and so forth, and just get used to seeing melanin.
So networking and community.
Yes, networking and community. So folks knew that folks that looked like them existed, as well as for the white folks to see, we're here. We're not going anywhere. We've always been in the industry. You know, this is not brand new. This is just we're coming outside and you can actually see us. So that is what my desire always was. Right. Just for it to be not normal to see people that were not white and cis male in the industry.
Alice, did you want to add more about the international aspect of it that you just mentioned?
Yeah, I just wanted to clarify that the subject at hand here that is under hot debate right now is Ree Felix's claim over Women in Comics convention, but he is somewhat extending that claim to Wink International too, even though he has sent out a recording where he has self-admittedly called himself the co-founder of Women in Comics Con and not Wink International.
Let me pause you just for a second so we can gather our understanding.
Yeah, help me out here.
So, Regine, or I'll say you, Regine, we'll start with you. You're the one who would go to these panels, like when you were by yourself at the very beginning, you would go to these panels, you would try to create some safe spaces, but you know, it wasn't anything that was fully formed yet. Ray came up to you, said, hey, why don't you create this space? Is that correct? Did he give you this idea and say, hey, let's create this space? Or why don't you take over this space? Or is this something that...
No, we started in 2012, and by 2015, we had our own collective.
So this is something you self-started and had already together.
Yeah,
and then
meeting ourselves.
And then meeting Ray, he was just the one that just said, hey, why don't you come do it in a convention?
Yep.
Okay, so that was because what I'm trying to do is really pinpoint and separate Ray's role in all this and I mean, I'm not a lawyer. I'm not going to talk about ownership. But I just want to express to everyone until there's clear points. So since 2012, this was a concept you've already been working on. You've already had this, I'm going to call it because it's collective. You already had things going on with this. Ray entered the picture, said, hey, why don't you guys come do my convention? Why don't you expand this to the conventions? You first said, was like, I'm not sure. But then you was like, yeah, let's do it. And now up until this point, up until 2021, that was all good. Is that correct?
Basically. I mean, we did do the first panel at Bronx Heroes, and we did do some events with him in terms of the art shows. Okay. But we did much more outside of that. So it wasn't just us just working with him and with his different art events. Yeah, we also did other panels.
Okay. He was just someone who said, hey, why don't you do my stuff? But you were already in the midst of that anyway.
We were. Okay. But we were co-collaborators in that sense. Like, we did co-curate the art shows, and then we co-created the convention.
The Bronx Comic Con?
Yeah. No, Bronx Heroes is his. It's separate.
Bronx Heroes is his own thing. Okay.
Yes, mm-hmm. It's completely separate. It's his company. Women in Comics Con was co-created by us. We were co-organizers of that show.
And then Women in Comics International is a whole
separate entity. Is that something?
Yes, it's a whole different entity. It's the organization. So the organization, we do other events. Mm-hmm. We host other things. We do workshops, we do panel discussions. You know, we've done other art shows outside of the ones that we did in the Bronx. You know, we help members brand themselves. We help them market themselves simply by just being on panels, and simply mm-hmm. just by them doing workshops. Because sometimes we get different partnerships. Like, we partner with the Brooklyn Library, for example, and we would send members to do workshops for kids. We did that for about 2 years, and we've had similar partnerships with other organizations. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, we're a big old community organization with members across the world, and we do a lot of stuff with a lot of folks.
Okay. So, let me ask this question then, because for those, I know a lot of people, a lot of our listeners, a lot of people out there don't know exactly what is going on right now.
Yeah,
with Ray. With this guy Ray and Women in Comics International. So, like, what is his claim, and what's the current situation, or what's been happening?
Before you answer that, I just want to read this email that set it all off. This was February 22nd. I'm not gonna read the whole email, but that's the main part.
Wait, that's not what set it off.
What set it off?
Oh, okay. Well, let's start there. What? So something happened prior to the February 22nd email.
Yes. What happened was, he sent me a cease and desist on February 9th.
Wow.
Wait,
slow down. Like one day y'all are chilling, doing shit together, and then one day you get a cease and desist letter?
Right. Was there any indicators prior?
No, except a gut feeling.
Ooh, ain't that the worst? Don't you always know it?
I'm very intuitive.
Been there and done that.
I'm very intuitive. Yeah. So, no, I received a cease and desist on February 9th.
Of this year?
Of this, yes.
2021. This year, okay.
Only a few weeks ago. And it stated that I had 30 days to take down the Women in Comics logo. Yes. And otherwise I'd be sued, or I had the option of buying him out.
And this is funny, because I was doing Twitter detective work, and
of course you were.
some people on Twitter pointed out had a very good point, that he put in a trademark for the phrase "women in comics," but it hasn't even been approved or even looked at yet. So how is he trying to send a cease and desist on a claim that isn't even legal yet? You know.
Well, here's the thing. I didn't know that was put in until after I received this cease and desist. So after I read the cease and desist, one of our members had called me, and she saw that the Women in Comics logo, he had been posting that he was doing a Women in Comics Con in the Bronx, had an R next to it.
Wow.
And I said, it has an R? So I went on the website and saw that he trademarked the term Women in Comics for conventions, awards, trade shows, and merchandise. So that's how I found out.
So let's sew all this together. Man. So as we said, from 2012, you've had this entity that, of course, has expanded along the way. It became Women Comics in Comics International. You around 2015. That's when you collaborated with him on the Women in Comics convention, but that was the extent of the relationship, the role. It was a more collaborative role. This is something you've started a long time ago. And of course, you've had various people, you know, join on to help, as we have Alice here, who's on the advisory board. There was no indicator. There was no conversation, no anything for all these years. And then on February 9th of 20, you found out that as of February 9th, 2021, Ray Felix claimed legal ownership of Women in Comics. And there is a pending trademark number right now. Or excuse me, it looks like even before that. So he claimed legal ownership of Women in Comics at the, you know, at the trademark office as of November 23rd, 2020.
Yes, my brother's birthday. And I had spoken to Ray the 22nd. And he gave no indicator that that's what he was doing. So the 23rd, the next day on my brother's birthday, he filed for this.
So this filing happened in November. You get told in February, November of 2020. In February 2021, you are become aware.
Yes.
Maybe needless to say, what was your first reaction? I would, as my friend from Florida would say, there would be some smoke in the city. I would tear the whole fucking shit down. Everything's getting burned to the ground. How did you feel?
I was livid. I was absolutely livid. And what made me so livid was not so much the sting for me, but I was thinking that, okay, so here is a cis man that is trademarking the term Women in Comics. So now there's no other Women in Comics organization or Women in Comics like event or panel at a convention that can use the term Women in Comics. Like, they can be sued. They can be sued for this term or be sent cease and desist for a term that belongs to the community.
I would be remiss if I didn't ask you this. Why wasn't the term trademarked prior?
I would never trademark that term.
No one should trademark that term
because it's colonizing. It's colonizing. It's coveting. That term belongs to a longstanding community. It's used to galvanize that community. Women in Comics is a term that's been used for 50 plus years, you know, in order to uplift women working in the comic book industry. I would never do that. And he, over the years, would ask me, like, oh, you don't want to trademark it? You should trademark it. No. And I would tell him, no. Like, no, so many people have used that term. I said, that's so despicable. that's what I said to him. I was like, absolutely not. And he did that. And all I can think about is the other women. Like, if this does go through, that will, can't use it or will be loathed to use it. Mm. You know, he's been saying online, like, oh, you know, I did it for the community. That's why I trademarked it. You know, I'm doing the Women in Comics Con now. So, you know, that term, that trademark belongs to the women that are going to be helping me organize a convention. Like, this is what the things that he's saying. And I'm like, it doesn't work that way. If it worked that way, then those person's names would at least be on the trademark with you. Those names are not on the trademark with you, you know? So for me, it feels like it was initially an attack on me, but then that affects millions, you know. I don't want to exaggerate, but millions across the country.
But also
internationally.
Yeah.
Also internationally, those are the implications of it. Even if he never sues anybody or goes after anybody, those are the implications of doing that.
Here's the issue. Go ahead. No, I'm sorry. Go ahead, Alice.
But also, like, good luck on him getting it, like, approved in the first place, because it's so generic, and again, like, it's owned by the entire culture. So it just seems like he doesn't have any case whatsoever.
Now, he's trademarking the term itself or the branding behind it. Like, what is he trying to take ownership of? Because I think people need to also understand what trademarking actually does and what the point of it is.
He more so is trademarking the term because he did upload, like, the bare bones Women in Comics logo that we had.
Your logo.
Yes, the original logo that we had. And that logo is one that he did initially put together. The font is from online. It's a free font.
Okay.
And originally he put the artwork of like Marvel and DC. And I said, those are licensed characters. You have to take that out of it. Like, we're going to get sued. And so from there, I got some artwork from other members and sent it to him. And then he put in what we all know as the standard Women in Comics logo. And then he put Bronx Heroes / Lock It Down on top.
And Lock It Down is your production company.
Is my brand. Mm-hmm. So, and then over the past about 5 or 6 months, I had been taking off the Bronx Heroes and Lock It Down because I just felt like it was coveting. It just felt like, you know, this isn't just belong to two people. Like, two people aren't gatekeepers of this movement. So I started taking it down because, again, he gave me this logo. He said, here, this is yours. You can have that. That's for you. Those were his exact words back in 2013. Okay. I remember dates, and I you know, I keep receipts. So, like, so that's what was said, you know, and I've been using it accordingly over the past 8 years as such, using it for whatever Women in Comics International Collective International's needs have been.
I've got a question. And I mean no disrespect to, you know, I mean, actually, I probably do mean all disrespect, but like, yes. How struggle is this man? Because something that I've noticed in my interactions with men is that when they are struggling in their own lives and when they have nothing going for them, they resort to ploys like this to attempt to get something for themselves.
I am so glad you brought that up.
I've been through a similar situation, and it involves a struggle-ass man, you know, to say the least. Let me say it like that, you know, and that's all we'll say on that. But,
you know.
Yeah, I know a struggle-ass mom when I see one.
I'd like to point out that I also think that this is a part of a pattern of behavior that
Facts.
He has exhibited, you know, and there is records to back this up that he has shown that he's been litigious before with very little evidence to back himself up. Like, he is currently in a legal fight with DC Comics over a character he created called Punchline, which is basically like a Harley Quinn ripoff. And now that DC has released another character that's another one of Joker's girlfriends named Punchline, he thinks that DC ripped him off.
Wow.
Even though they look nothing alike, and even though it's such an obvious idea, like, a Joker's like clown girlfriend might be named Punchline. Like, no one could think of that, right? he's been complaining about this lawsuit with DC, or this copyright infringement issue with DC, for years, playing the victim, saying that, like, complaining about his trademark being infringed on. And then he goes and turns around and infringes on his friend's trademark. I mean, come on. Like, stealing the Women in Comics trademark from Regine, who opted not to trademark it herself because of all those, you know, selfless reasons, honestly. So it seems to me that his lacking in power in these spheres definitely is contributing to him trying to grab power in this other sphere and grab power from women. Which, again, I mentioned a recording before that he posted. So let me give you some context around that.
Yes, please.
When all this came out, he put about a dozen women that he assumed were members of Wink into a private group chat, but not all of them are members. Like, he doesn't even know who the members are or are not. So there are a handful of women in here that aren't even members. He doesn't even know that I'm on the advisory board. Otherwise, I don't think he would have put me on that chat.
Oh, wait. So he created a private chat to try to, I guess, drum up support for himself? And included you, who is an advisory board member. But he probably has no idea your role and other people, clearly.
Exactly. Okay. This Got it. Goes to show how ignorant and how uninvolved he is with the umbrella organization of Wink. Like, he's only the co-creator of the convention, again, which I'm saying is only a fraction of what Wink does.
Mm-hmm.
So he's trying to steal members from Wink into his this new organization he's trying to create under his, you know, pending trademark. And in this private chat, he posted a recording. I don't know, like, you remember Dace Regine. Do you remember when that recording was from?
Yes, that was from 2019. I believe it was right before New York Comic Con.
Okay. Yeah, so in this recording, he is actually saying himself, I am the co-creator of Women in Comics Con. I am not involved with Women in Comics International. But then he goes on to tell Regine how she should be doing this and that with the financials. She should be charging a membership fee. Like, this is in the recording that he sent everyone, right? And while we do charge membership fees now, we didn't back then. But in this group chat that he started, he tried to make it a moral, like, standpoint that he said he will never charge membership fees for people in his Women in Comics group because he believes it should be, you know, accessible to everyone, even though he was the one who gave Regine the idea or started or, like, planted that idea to begin with.
I just don't understand how a dude is trying to get away with this.
I mean, it's called Women in Comics. So I mean,
you know, the days of 2021's internet, I just don't understand. Like, fam, like I said, it's just the first I'm hearing. Like, it'll just be a tweet away. Like, fam, what a failure you are, dog. Like, what a loser.
I have a question, and this is, and I want to be very, very precise that, you know, this is not imparting blame or anything. I'm just trying to understand the relationship between people. You mentioned how, and maybe it was spurred by this whole trademark situation, how you realize you look back and he does have a history of being litigious and all this other stuff. Was he, and again, this, it was from a collaborative standpoint, but was he always this person that was cool to work with? Like, were there any warning signs before or anything of that nature?
Well, in terms of the litigiousness, yes. Mm-hmm. You know, for sure. Okay. For sure. Because I think a lot of us who are in the indie community, we watched as, you know, as you know, he made claim to various things. And a part of us, a lot of us are like, we know that sometimes things can happen with larger companies where things can get stolen. Like, we know that that's a possibility. So when someone says it, you know, we pay attention to it. When someone is very, very, feels very strongly about it. And I would speak to him about it, over the years. Specifically, for about a year. But over the years, he had mentioned that people had stolen, like, characters of his, and, you know, it made him feel like he was very angry about it, and it really bothered him and so forth. So I had compassion for that. Other people had compassion for that because it has happened. So that was always, you know, in the back of my mind, like, okay, like, this can possibly switch up on me, you know? So I saw somewhere inside of my body was mentally prepared, because at the same time, you know, he could be really, you know, just in general, just a cool person, a caring person. Like, I cared about Ray to whatever extent I still do, you know, because that compassion is still there, even though I'm high key angry. I'm high key angry. And I'm not, you know, I'm not doubling back on that anger. You know, it's like that anger is there and it's staying there. But you have compassion for that, you know, at the possibility of someone getting their stuff stolen. So it isn't until, like, within like, let's say the last 2 years, like specifically around the time that he did call me in 2019. Well, actually, I think I called him and then he probably called me back and then pressed record to record me.
Wow.
So he recorded you secretly?
Right? Yes, without my knowledge. Okay. And he also recorded me previously. I mean, not previously. I mean, he recorded me apparently the last conversation I had with him, which was in early February, right before he sent the cease and desist, he's posted about it, that he has a recording of me, and then he also sent me a text message, said, because he was upset that we as an organization made a public statement, and he sent me a text message saying, you know, I knew you were going to do something like this, so I recorded you, and it's going to prove that, you know, you said that I could have the logo and I could have the convention, and everyone's going to know that you're a thief and a fraud.
But you're giving him the logo and the convention, so shouldn't that be
that?
Like,
I did respond to a cease and desist and said, you can have the logo and you can have the convention, because for me, it's about the organization. It's about the people. It's about the membership. Like women in comics, you know, it's beyond just panel discussions and workshops. I've said this recently where it's like, you know, I don't think he's taking any calls from members at 7 o'clock in the morning who are being stalked by dudes in the industry, or held a member in the bathroom crying because, you know, there's been an issue at her table. I mean, remember one year we were at a convention and some guy, like, we had a member that was standing on a chair and they were, whoever was behind our booth, like, actually knocked her down. And like, we were like ready to brawl right in the middle of New York Comic Con. Like, we will.
So Wink International are also goons. Okay. Got it.
We protect our own. And I think, yeah, you know, Ray has been feeling that lately. So he's really like, kind of like really upset, because he's been saying like, oh, like, you know, people are coming after me on Twitter, you know, and they shouldn't be. But then he's been harassing members on Twitter. That he made a spam bot that was going after members. One of our members, he was screenshotting what they were saying and resharing it. And it was members and supporters. You know, and for me, it's like, you don't mess with our people. You don't mess with family. You know, that's what set my anger all the way to 10. And I like to keep it on the level. But once you start messing with our members, you know, a organization of folks who are marginalized and one of the most vulnerable communities in comics as a whole, you messed up. Mm-hmm. You messed up. It's like now we have to, you know. That's when I started coming out and talking about it. Cause on Twitter, I said, if I say anything, it's not going to be the best thing that comes out of me. So I'd rather go on shows such as For All Nerds and just say what's going on and how we feel and what our community's about.
Right. So I had to take a drink of water. I had to think about it. I had to pause myself. With this being said, like, I mean, Alice made a great point. You know, this is, it's really super 50-50, maybe even lower, that he would even get granted this trademark, considering it's such a generic term. But, you know, if you are somehow able to express sufficiently specific usage and all that, maybe you can get away with it. I don't know if you all are doing anything, or you're just kind of hoping that it's just not going to go through. But was Wink taking any steps against Felix at this point, or against his claim, or what are you all doing? I mean, what you're doing now is actually perfect, getting the word out, communicating all of this stuff. I mean, that email was at least, you know, from a basic standpoint, was perfect, because the flags went up. Like, wait a minute, what's going on here? So with that understanding, are you all taking any legal action yourselves, or what else is happening?
Well, currently, we're just making sure that our members know where we stand and, you know, who we are, and that we're not associated with him at this juncture, especially when it comes to the Women in Comics Con. So that first email went out that had our business statement saying that, you know, we're separated from our association with him. And then we had another email come out this week. I don't know if y'all got it, but we did post it on Twitter, and it was a statement of the organization again about what we stand for and what the whole situation is about. So our primary focus is letting our members know that we're here, we're not going anywhere. You know, at the end of the day, there are other organizations that have Women in Comics in their name, or they have Women in Comics events specifically. There's several Women in Comics cons. They don't call themselves that, but you have Geek Girl Con, you have Ladies Con, you have WisCon. I know I'm missing somebody else, but Comic Con. So there are a bunch of organizations that this affects directly. Mm-hmm. So I think we're all watching and looking and seeing. But at the end of the day, Women in Comics is a very generic term, very, very generic term. So we're going to keep an eye out. I just, so everyone knows, I already trademarked, it was in the process, Women in Comics Collective International.
Okay, that was my question.
That's very specific. It's very specific. We want it to be specific. Again, Women in Comics is just too loosey-goosey. So that process is happening, and we did apply to be a nonprofit entity in New York State. So that's that that was back in January that that was done. So in the process of that, so we are already like working on our next chapter, because it's what matters is the membership. As long as they feel comfortable and safe, that's all that matters to us. And this situation has brought some upheaval. So we're just letting them know, like, look, we're not going to let nobody get at you. You know, the membership is very protective of me. Our supporters are very protective of our organization and me as well. So that's what holds precedent, how we take care of each other.
Okay. So you are, as you mentioned, you are taking steps to protect Women in Comics International from any future, I'm sorry to say, but any future grabbing attempts like this. And so what does that mean then for Women in Comics, the convention part of this? That, as you said, you've made it clear that you completely separated from that. Does that mean anything he does with that has nothing to do with you all, and people should understand that those are two separate entities?
Correct. So if you see Bronx Heroes presents Women in Comics, that's not us. That's not us. We do have events. Like we're having virtual events, you know?
Yeah.
In terms of conventions, I mean, right now, I mean, his intention is to have a live convention.
Wow.
In person in the summer. And that's not happening. Nope. Like that's not happening. I'm not doing any conventions at all. San Diego Comic-Con just canceled. Go ahead, Alice.
I was trying to find like what was his exact phrase. He said like because of like COVID, like
inactivity
due to COVID or something like that, as if COVID is now over.
It doesn't work like that. It really doesn't work. Alice, as a person on the advisory board, what are your feelings? Like, what is your personal views of just kind of just everything in the aggregate and how to move forward?
I think that we're taking the appropriate steps now. At first, we were just really like focusing on how to assure the members of our future, like of all the positive things we have in the mix going forward.
Yeah,
we have a magazine coming out. We have all these opportunities for members to contribute to.
Okay.
So we were trying to keep that focus on ourselves and on that positivity. But once more things started coming out with private chats and recordings here and there, we decided the best defense is a good offense, and we needed to put our point of view out there loud and clear. And that is what we're doing right now.
Absolutely. And you know, we mentioned it briefly when we first started talking, but as you all are saying, there are more things coming out. There are virtual events, at least right now. In the future, when things are more safe, I'm sure you'll put on the physical events again. But between both Women in Comics International and your own personal self, like, can you tell us more about some of the projects you're working on?
The ones that are out right now.
The ones that are out and the ones that you can talk about.
Yeah. Okay. So I did my first short story with DC Comics, and that was in their, oh gosh, that's the longest title ever. Dark Knights Metal, Death Metal, Last 52 of the Multiverse. I probably didn't say it properly. Forgive me, DC Comics.
I'll look it up. Okay.
Just look at like Last 52, like of the Multiverse, and it should pop up. It's the last anthology that came out on December 29th. But I did a story about Lois Lane.
Okay.
And an evil Lois Lane, the evil counterpart. And that was that was so much fun.
I've never thought of an evil Lois. And you were right. It's called Dark Knights, Death Metal, The Last 52, War of the Multiverses.
Okay, I did pretty good.
Yeah, so you got it. So you have a story about Lois going heel, Lois Lane going heel, turning heel. What else?
She meets her heel, essentially. She meets her doppelganger, her evil doppelganger. So that was really dope. And then after that, I wrote a short story for the Valentine's Day issue. Mm-hmm. Or I guess it's an anthology. It was called Love is a Battlefield. And I did a short story on Big Barda and Mr. Miracle.
Nice.
And them celebrating their anniversary in a very rough and tumble way. Then the other story I did was for their Represent series. And that's a DC Digital First story. And I semi-autobiographical, a lot of folks don't know, I studied to be a chef. And I basically wrote about how my father reacted when I when I told him I wanted to be a chef. He was a World War II vet from Alabama, and he was like, "We've grown past that. What are you talking about?" As a people, like as Black folks, like what? I mean, no, he was. I mean, in the book, I have him. I have the character, the father character, to be a little bit more stern. But my father just said, "You don't want to be a doctor or a lawyer?" Mm-hmm. Like he, I said, "No, Daddy, I want to be a chef." And I'm like, well, we cooked all the time together. He and I, we cooked all the time together. I cooked all the time with my brother, with my grandmother, and sometimes my mother. So it was in me. My brother is a chef. Mm. He's a retired chef. So it was in me. So I wrote a short story that's loosely based based on that. So yeah, those are the stories that I had done. I also had a story with A Wave Blue World last year for their Maybe Someday anthology. And for this year, you know, there's a few other anthologies that are coming.
Excellent.
Things on the calendar. I'll also be doing some more stuff with my Lock It Down work. So I'm excited about that too.
Right.
So it's just, the world is an oyster. We'll see where it's going to go.
Right.
But
So how do people, how do women, or and also, is it just for women? And can people who are allies also join, whatever the term you want to use for them? How do they join Women in Comics International?
Yes, anybody can join WINC. It's open to whoever would like to come. You can just go to the website. You go to memberships, and there's a list of various memberships that are there. And we have one, actually, it's called True Ally. And a True Ally membership is for folks who want to pay for a membership for themselves, a pro membership, and then pay for one for somebody else that can't afford it.
Oh, okay. And what was the website that people go to?
Is www.womenincomicscollective.org.
Okay. And also, Alice, you know, I know that you're also within this space. Did you have any things that you're working on that you could talk about right now that you wanted to mention?
Yeah. So outside of WINC, I am an illustrator / comic book artist. Mm. So I just put out a 10-page comic for Z2 Comics based on Beethoven's music called The Final Symphony. Has a gorgeous cover by David Mack. I just also contributed a portrait of Freddie Mercury to their upcoming Freddie Mercury anthology. I specifically painted him in bisexual lighting to represent
The purple and pink.
Yes, exactly.
what I'm wearing right now.
Yeah.
It just happens. Yeah.
Last year, I had work that came out in the official Ghostbusters art book.
Congratulations on that.
Thank you. Later this month, I have work coming out in the official Firefly art book, although I did that before all the weed and stuff came out. So I'm like, I don't know.
I thought you said weed stuff. I was like, wait, weed and Firefly? They got a strain I need to try?
Oh,
there might be a strain called Firefly.
I'm sure. There has to be. That would be a complete oversight if it's not.
Yeah, the weed and stuff in Firefly. Don't hold your breath.
And this Sunday, I'm going to be appearing on Adobe Radio, which is a Washington, D.C. based alt rock station, talking about the finale to WandaVision.
Oh,
excellent.
Dope.
Very good. Now, for those who are going to join, because I know for after this interview, people are going to want to join Women in Comics Collective International. What are they going to get when they become a member? What are they going to become a part of?
Well, they're going to become a part of a family and a community of loving people who are here to support and protect. We also, during this COVID time, we have a lot of discounts for members. So we have members, we have discounts for art supplies. We have discounts on wellness memberships. We also do a full resource link page that's updated bi-weekly that has grant information, has law information. We also have a law membership partnership that we have where they can get law services at a very, very discounted price. We have resources for gender equity, racial equality, like the whole gamut. I feel like I'm putting stuff up there every 5 minutes. It's like I just want everyone to have everything they can get out of this industry.
Mm-hmm. And then this is and industry specifically within comics and graphic novels and everything.
Multimedia, transmedia, whatever they need, we're gonna get it for you. We'll do our best.
Excellent. Well, please, before we go, please, both Alice and Regine, can you please share where people can find you online?
Yeah, you can find me this is Alice. You can find me anywhere at Alice Meichi. That's AliceMeichi. And that's me on Twitter and Instagram for now. Otherwise, I have most of my art that's on sale is at Gallery 1988's page. So just like type in Alice Meichi and all my prints should show up.
Excellent.
So on Twitter, I'm at Lockedown, LockedTTDown. Also, you can follow at Women in Comics on all the things at WINCNYC. I also wanted to say that we are taking submissions for our very first Wink magazine. We are paying people, so get on the website so you can check out our submissions guidelines. We're taking full stories, we're taking poems, we're taking editorial comics, we're taking a whole bunch of stuff, so definitely check that out.
Excellent. Well, thank you both for being here. Thank you for explaining to us exactly what happened, what's going on, and how you all are moving forward. You know, definitely we'll continue to support Women in Comics International and the both of you and everything you're doing. And again, we just wish you the best and wish you love. And again, very sorry that this happened. You should not have to go through this whatsoever.
Thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Absolutely. All right, fam, we'll be back in just a bit to give you more of 4L Nerds.
I'm Professor Brandon Obunu.
This is Danny Lohr.
And this is Vita Ayala.
My name is Genevieve King.
This is Peter Ramsey.
This is Hiro Karangawa.
This is Lexi Alexander.
This is Ato Asado.
And you are listening to...
I am listening to...
I'm listening to...
I like to listen to...
I'm listening to...
I'm listening to...
We are listening to...
For All Nerds. Do it.
Welcome back, Fan Fam. Yo, as we said, that was a lot. That's a lot. But, you know, we want to definitely thank Alice Meichi as well as Regine Sawyer for coming through to explain to us everything that's happened with Women in Comics International. I'm beside myself, really. Like,
this is my first time hearing about it.
Like, you know? I heard about it, but I didn't realize the depths. Of the lows that we can be in, but here we are. I don't like that shit. I'm just gonna say it like that. I'm gonna leave it there. I don't like that shit.
I'll go further. I don't like that shit at all. I think that man is trash. I think the whole style is chump. I think everything about him. I don't fuck with him as a record label.
That's a record label. Listen. I don't even know how to say this. I would love to hear what kind of. To the contrary point, this one has, but that ain't the way.
That's not my thing is like this. Let me just be clear, right? Like, even if you did found it, you know, even if you were involved with the convention, which they say you were, and, you know, you own that and you can have that, like they said you could. My thing is, dog, you're a man out here trying to run a Women in Comics convention. How does that look? I don't care if it was originally all your idea. Like I always say, like I was telling you during the break, if you are a dude out here in these industries and you don't have women by your side in prominent positions, I question you immediately because I know dudes and I know how we get down. And so it's like, if you don't have somebody checking your dumb ass.
Bloop! know, we'll leave it at that.
you know, then we see what happens.
We'll leave it at that.
Chris D'Elia.
Oh, don't talk about him. He got that one. That's another one with problems.
I love the articles because it's always his face, and his face is always looking surprised.
Because they're trying to play him. I love it.
I love
that's
it.
When you're supposed to play people. But
I love it.
But it's time. It's time for one of our favorite segments.
The guac is extra. Keep when the ask questions. We answer any and all listener questions. All you have to do is hit us up on the Twitters, on the Instagrams, at For All Nerds. And you can also hit us, contact@forallnerds.com. Mm-hmm. And, you know, whatever you got on your mind, don't matter if it's geek-related or not, as you will see, because we have a returning champion to the guac tonight.
You were talking about how that you missed them. You haven't heard.
I did.
Him.
You know what I mean? Like, come on, man. I love it. Like, y'all don't understand. I began to aggravate all that, but I love all the listeners. You know, I love everybody who listens to the show. Because it means if you take the time to actually listen to this, you know, it's. Yeah. And then if you take the time to actually engage with us, you know.
Yeah, it matters.
It matters. Because I remember when there was nothing, you know what I mean? So it's like.
But no one was giving you time of day, right?
Yeah, so I try and be, you know, but sometimes, you know, I'm a human being at the same time. So it's like when 50 people hit me about one thing, you know, it's just because it's a cicada, not a locust. I'm like, bruh.
All right, to the matter at hand.
I don't care. Both of them got ate by that rabbit.
To the matter at hand, we're keeping it lightweight this week with the person that you missed. This is Maze, longtime listener and a supporter. So here goes Maze's guac question. They write, "Yeah, say my name and I'll be there." Is what?
because he hadn't been here. So and we remember on the Twitch we were talking about, yo, where's Maze?
Oh,
you know,
okay.
And so, you know, say my name and I'll be there. Boom. You know, come on.
All right. So he goes, "What's up, fan fam? It's Maze, aka Maze Windu."
I mean,
that's actually good.
Why did you use that? Why did you leave?
Right. You should have left with that like 3 years ago, Maze. Jesus. Major Bane instead of Major Pain. What is coming up with the good ones now? He had to take a hiatus.
Especially because I love Major Pain. That shit is so terrible. Wow. It's so good.
The next one is Black Boy Wonder.
I had to think about it, but that's not bad either.
Very good. Slim Stimmy. Okay.
I don't get it. Yeah, I don't know.
Okay. And two more. Jabba the Hutt.
I've heard that before. Yeah, it just makes me laugh. But I've
heard
it.
And this one I actually really like. Beanie Smeagol.
You know, I've just been rewatching them shits too. Like, I mean, right now I'm right on.
What, Lord of the Rings?
Yes, right now I am on Smeagol. You know, I'm on the Two Towers right now. Like,
Maze, where were these AKAs?
Yes.
Like, every. Like, this is the gold
Smeagol
standard.
Is amazing.
This is the gold standard. This is high grade.
Yeah, that is funny.
You was giving us mid for so long. All right, well, maybe you needed the mids out of the way to get the gold. We get it.
Yeah, Beanie right. Smeagol is amazing. That's great.
I love that one. So the question goes, "Hope all is well. I've had a crazy month and won't hold you with all the details. Just know I had to get a new car unexpectedly and that I may have a baby on the way." What?
Hopefully these did not, like, you know, intertwine, these two incidents.
Oh, no. Right.
You having to get a new car, you know, I hope whatever led to that was not you having to get, you know.
Right.
If it did, then you live in a good life, too. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? Like, hey.
So Maze may have a baby on the way. He continues to write, "Me and my wife have been doing the in vitro process and will know the sex of the baby next week. With that said, I wanted to throw my wife off her game with some baby name suggestions." Mm. She has a couple of mine, but I want to see how she responds to y'all's suggestions. Peace and love, Maze.
Man, with all the AKAs you throw out, I want to know what y'all.
Right. Well, this is funny because for like a year, I was yelling about how we have not been able to name another child. It's like 2 years or so.
Someone else DM'd us too recently, and I don't know what happened. Whoever that was, just somebody DM'd us and was like, "Yo, I'm going to send y'all something about naming my kid too." And they had like another question, and then I don't know. Their wife must have been like, "Nah, B."
So, what's some names we got for them? Mm. What's some names we got for them?
Mm. And now we stuck with nothing, right?
Now we stuck with nothing. Yeah.
Xavier.
Aurora.
Mm. Okay.
Hey, Storm.
There you go. Monroe.
Monroe. just plain this Monroe by itself as a first name?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. And I'm trying to think of like names that could be either gender.
Mm.
Or not non-gender conforming either.
True,
so like
true.
Because they don't know the sex of the baby.
Sam.
Just straight up Sam.
Samantha,
that's true.
You know, or Sam, that's you know, either way, you know, and then on your left. There you go.
On your left.
You know, you
Sam
can be
on your
and,
left, Maze.
You know, Maze is all like, yes.
Or even the names of like items within the MCU that are important to know. Like, I don't know. I don't think you're gonna name your child Agatha or anything like that.
No, ooh, that's not a good look. That's like when people were naming their kids Khaleesi or
Khaleesi. Oh, I know a Khaleesi. Yeah.
You do?
I do a baby. Yeah.
Did she had it seen the end, right?
The baby's name is Khaleesi.
Ooh.
Callie.
Yeah.
Callie.
Yeah, that's what you got to go with there.
Yeah. I mean, if you want to do Khaleesi, just do the
Callie
more,
is
I guess
new
the
nickname.
Short version.
Yeah.
Callie.
Yeah.
I don't know. We're not really super hot on a name right now, but I like what you came up with so far.
Yeah, I like Xavier Aurora Monroe. T'Challa is so no.
No, I don't like that.
Mm-mm. I like I Sam. I always liked Sam. That's just always been a great name to me too.
I think Sam is strong.
Yep.
I like Sam. Okay, so we're probably gonna give you some more because I know as soon as we stop recording, we're gonna think of a bunch more.
Facts.
So we'll send it to you personally, Maze. But maybe everyone listening has some ideas. If you have some ideas of baby names for Maze or maybe one of your upcoming kids or whatever the case may be, hit us up. And if you have any questions for us in general, hit us up. Contact at forallnerds.com. If you want a little bit of privacy or you want to just email us, that's what you like. Otherwise, you can hit us up on our socials. At forallnerds is where we at when it comes to IG and Twitter and even Facebook. And as we said before, love, love, love to the Patreon fan fam. If you are on the Patreon, you also get pretty much a guaranteed guac question. That's patreon.com/forallnerds. Send us a message at any point and we will log your question.
Mm-hmm. And I think that is about it tonight, folks. It has been one hell of an episode as always. Thank you for joining us here. Thank you for Regine and for I don't want to butcher their names. I've been on a streak of not butchering names, so I'll just let you handle it.
Oh, so you're trying to say the names. Regine
yes.
Sawyer
yes,
and Alice Maychilene.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you to both of y'all for joining us tonight and for, you know, dropping the knowledge in the game because, you know, they out here looking real. You know,
Ben, I got to say what you be saying. Men are trash! Ben Bros come back. I'm about to wreck your body as they turn a body out. I'm about to wreck your body as they turn a body out. I'm about to wreck your body as they turn a body out. I'm about to wreck your body as they turn a body out. I'm about to wreck your body as they turn a body out. I'm about to wreck your body as they turn a body out. I'm about to wreck your body as they turn a body out. I'm about to wreck your body as they turn a body out. Yeah, I know it looks pathetic. Ali Shaheed Muhammad got me doing calisthenics. Needless to say, boy, I'm bad to the bone. Making love to my mic like Jerome on the phone. But no time for jokes. What? There's bills to be paid. What? Hoes to be laid. What? Punks to be sprayed. What? Chumps to attack. So my man, watch your back. 93 means skills are a must, so never lack. Sit back and learn. Come now, watch the birdie. His house are incomplete, same as Vinny Testaverde.